welcome to the Valley for a comprehensive review of Charlton's third successive season in the Premiership. Now, it's the oldest cliche in football that it's a game of two halves. Well, here we have a case for a season of three thirds, indifferent at the start and at the finish, but scintillating in the middle.
During the close season, Gary Rowett signed from Leicester for £3.5 million. Paul Rabchupka joined from Manchester United for £200,000 as cover for Dean Kiley. Andy Todd departed to Blackburn for £750,000, whilst Greg Shields returned to his native Scotland and joined Kilmarnock. Popular centre-half Eddie Youds left for Huddersfield. Young striker Charlie McDonald was released. And Martin Pringle would never recover from his serious leg injury and eventually retired.
OK, then, you've got your season ticket. Thank you very much. Your programme has brought you bang up to date. A cup of tea and a pie at the ready. The big kickoff was against Chelsea last August.
Oh, and it kicked off all right. Both matches against Chelsea this time round will live long in the memory.
Young. Graham Stewart's made a run from deep, forcing Babayaro into a rather hasty clearance. Ferrer, poor. Jensen, good ball. Chance for Konchesky! What a start to the season for Paul Konchesky and Charlton. Ahead after 6 minutes. And how many times have we said it before, but Chelsea contributed fully to their own problems. Ferrer might have cleared but didn't. Good ball by Jensen. Fine finish by Konchesky. Clean and crisp and deadly accurate. Zenden. Oh, Hasselbank has got away from Rowett. And Rowett can't catch him. And it's still Hasselbank. And Luke Young got back, helped by Rowett to make a crucial challenge. Rowett's no slouch, but ordinarily you would have thought that Hasselbank would have gone clear. In by Zenden, out by Stewart. Oh, De Lucas, challenged badly by Paul Konchesky. Oh, it's red! And the man who has put Charlton in front will play no further part in the match. Paul Konchesky sent off for a dangerous challenge on Kike De Lucas. Some achievement for Charlton to score another with a numerical disadvantage. This is Jensen. Rufus! No! Referee spotted an infringement, blew his whistle. But the goal will stand. Chelsea protest. They can't believe the goal has been given. But Richard Rufus has put Charlton two up. It was the incident in the six-yard box that has caused Chelsea so much anger. They felt there was a foul by Jason Yule on William Gallas. The whistle went, seemingly, as the ball was entering the net. But it is 2-0, Rufus has scored, and the 10 men have managed to get a goal against the 11. Lampard. Zenden, that's nice footwork away from Young. Two waiting. Zola! 2-1! Alan Kirbishley embarking on his 12th season as manager or joint manager of Charlton. Only one man has served longer in the job. The great Jimmy Seed, whose name is immortalised here at the Valley, was in charge for 23 years either side of the Second World War. Cole thought about the shot, but he's still going, and he's equalised! And that's why Chelsea are putting so much faith in 18-year-old Carlton Cole. Young. Svensson! Well, he's not scored for well in excess of a year. That would have been some moment so late in the game. Fittuccini, I think, was always going to get there. But just for a moment, Svensson thought he'd poached a winner. Gudjonsson to Cole. Oh, and Lampard! 89th minute. Frank Lampard may well have won it for Chelsea.
Would you have won the game if Konchesky had stayed on?
Well, then I bet if we'd have won it, but we might have contributed to a bit more in terms of attacking. But to go two up and then let a goal in the last minute of the first half and then survive the second, then nearly nick it ourselves at 2-2 and then to let one in the last minute, it's a bit painful.
6 days later and big, big news reverberated round these parts as Mark Kinsella was sold to Aston Villa for £1 million. Charlton's captain Fantastic was the driving force behind the team's resurgence in the late 90s, victoriously leading the Addicts to playoff final success and ultimately to the First Division Championship.
Kinsella! It's a screamer of a goal! Kinsella scores as well.
Kinsella well forward, Stewart on the run. And back in again to Kinsella. And that one has gone in. It's 3-0. And the captain, Mark Kinsella, scores.
Kinsella's contribution to this football club will never be forgotten, but Alan Kirbishley had decided that changes were needed. Scott Parker was the first choice replacement, but his untimely ankle injury pre-season was to take much longer than expected to heal. Graham Stewart captained the team at Bolton, but his season was about to be cruelly cut short.
And Barnes. It's a really bright start from Bolton Wanderers. Gardner back to Franson. This is Warhurst. Oh, great effort. Well kicked out by Kylie. Dual caps in there. Bolton lead in the second minute. Yuri Djorkaeff with another goal against Charlton. He got two at the Valley last season. Gary Rowett leaving the action injured. More concern for Alan Kirbishley. The new signing giving way to an old stager. The dependable warhorse Steve Brown into the action. And that with just 5 minutes played. Big Charlton presence in the Bolton penalty area as Klaus Jensen prepares to deliver. Delivered deep. And Rufus has gone down and a penalty has been awarded. Richard Rufus applauds the decision. Referee Matt Messias is unmoved despite the Bolton protests. It's the third penalty Bolton have conceded in two games this season. Richard Rufus, adjudged to have been shoved out of the way by Pedersen. Certainly flung himself determinedly at the ball. Made contact with Rufus, it would seem. Chris Bart-Williams with the chance to level for Charlton. Boos around the Reebok. Bart-Williams stays cool and calm and slots it into the corner. Charlton level to silence the home crowd. To play keep ball and just wait for the chance to attack at pace. Chance might come here with Johansson. Got Jensen in support, there's Yule in the middle. Bursting forward is Stewart, and here's Jason Yule, and that's 2-1 Charlton. The finish from Yule, they've come from behind to lead at the Reebok. Credit too for Graham Stewart. The way he burst from midfield. Getting there before Franson. think he took a knock as he won the ball, but still had the presence to find Yule. The challenge from Franson certainly caught Stewart, but he kept his feet, kept the move going, and Yule scores. Stewart has stayed down. That's where he took the knock. He just pulled up slightly. Really good work from the Charlton midfielder. Good approach play from Johansson and Jensen in the first instance. Still plenty to do for Stewart here. Ewell had the simplest of tasks. Graham Stewart has picked up an injury in the build-up to that goal. He'll take no further part. And Gotti tries to keep Bolton moving forward. Decent cross too. And the chance will fall to Nolan. Good parry by Kiley. And the rebound fell to Nolan too quickly for him to react. It's a goal kick. That is a really good block from the Charlton Athletic number one. May just have made sure that all 3 points go back to the Valley. Fell kindly for Nolan. Struck it in an instant, but Kiley stood big.
Will you be celebrating tonight 300 games in charge of Charlton? Is that Charlton?
Right? Oh, I didn't know that. I know we're back in it again. You know, you sort of played last week and massive disappointment. And as I said, it took a long while to get over it. And then you go and win today. And then, you know, you got two injuries which can keep players out for some time. So, you know, back in it now. And let's get on with it. You know, the season started.
Well, I think it was very important for us to win today. I think you could see that both teams knew it was a very, really important game. And it was a very tight game. And in the end, we won 2-1. So, very important win, I think.
Now, Charlton fans might be asking tonight why you allowed Mark Kinsella to go. What would you say to them?
Well, I think it's well documented what I said yesterday, but basically, you know, clubs have to move on. And Mark has been fantastic for Charlton Athletic. I said it yesterday. I think his career has run parallel with the team. You know, we've had a fantastic 7 years together. And he was a big favourite with the fans. But I'm looking at people like Scott Parker and Klaus Jensen, who I don't think I can stop them from progressing. I've got Chris Bart-Williams, who played very well again today. So, you know, perhaps it was time for a change. And Mark left the club on great terms with everybody. It's not a problem. And, you know, so nothing stays the same. That's what I was trying to say yesterday. And we wish him all the best. I know he's playing today. I hope he had a good game. But we've got to move on. And as I say, it was time for a change.
Richard Rufus stepped forward as captain for the visit of Tottenham to the Valley, but there was to be no home comfort. Watching in the stand was Alessandro Dos Santos, better known as Alex. He'd had an excellent World Cup for Japan and was all set to sign, only to be denied a work permit.
Still a chance for Tottenham with Davis looking for the 1-2 with Sheringham, and Davis is in on goal! It's a wonderful strike from Simon Davis. A neat 1-2, and absolutely nothing Dean Kiley could do about that. Yule getting the better of Tirico. Here's Jason Yule! And Keller again to the rescue for Tottenham. Didn't do a lot wrong, did he, Jason Yule? And Keller reacting splendidly to push that behind.
Luke Young with his usual trick here of hurling it deep into the penalty area towards Rufus. And Jensen! Oh, what a start for Charlton! David James is beaten inside 4 minutes in the West Ham goal, and Klaus Jensen is the scorer. The man who missed so much of last season is back on the score sheet straight away as West Ham failed to clear and were punished clinically by Jensen. The muddle in the West Ham defence, Daly and Cisse couldn't clear it, and it fell so nicely for Klaus Jensen. Winterman. Trevor Sinclair. It's back inside, sees the run from Winterburn. This is Defoe. Tries one himself. That's an even better save from Dean Kiley. Really had to get down well from the young England striker.
and he wouldn't have seen that much of it. But a strong hand clears it away from the danger as it went through Richard Rufus's legs. So what can Charlton do with just a minute to go before the interval? It'll be Klaus Jensen, the goal scorer, who will take this corner. Swings it in. Svensson cleared off the line. Fortune, it's wriggled its way in. And Charlton are 2-0 up. And of all the people, John Fortune, who comes from a family of West Ham fans, should score on the stroke of half-time against the Hammers and record his first ever Premiership goal. It's gone through three or four legs, and it's 2-0 to Charlton. Chris Powell then with a throw towards Bartlett, and Yule! Oh, what a first touch from Sean Bartlett, and a perfectly worked move. And Jason Yule's header was not very far away. David James was beaten all ends up, and well, why is Repka putting his hands up for offside? It was a throw-in, for goodness sake. The overlap from Jensen. The step over. He still has it. And shoots! Well, it looked like, for all the world, that David James got a touch on it, but the referee says no. Jensen, who scored after just 4 minutes. Well, that was turned away. Carrick. Chip ball forward, again towards Defoe. Oh, and Steve Lomas has just stabbed it wide. I think they could go on playing all night and West Ham wouldn't score today. Lomas, very wide. And there is the final whistle. The boos are for West Ham. The celebrations for Alan Kerbishley. It's another away win for Charlton. If only they could win at home. But at least they're in the top half of the table. Final score at Upton Park, West Ham 0, Charlton 2.
We've come here the last couple of seasons and been on the back foot early. But we got the start this time and, you know, perfect start for us. And then I think the boys had something to defend and something not to hang on to because it was so early, but something to defend, and that always gives you a little bit of a boost.
The August transfer deadline had fallen just prior to the West Ham game. Jesper Blomqvist and Robbie Musto were signed to bolster the squad's depleted numbers and eventually each given one-season deals. Next, the away record crumbled at Villa Park. September proved to be a very testing month.
Just over Klaus Jensen's head. This is Angel. Fed it through to De La Cruz. He's gone past two, past three, and he's scored! 20 minutes from time. And some individual brilliance combined with some poor Charlton defending left entirely exposed. The deadlock's broken. Brown goes long this time. Svensson got a flick on it. Oh, it's come through to Luke Young. Great chance! And it was a defender's finish. And get. This is Moore. Allowed him to run at them. It's Stephen Moore. And that'll finish it. The substitute gets the second. He just walks through. 8 minutes from time. It's 2-0.
Vieira's made a good run as well. Henry's gone near post. He's gone far post to Wiltord! Kiley with a save. Fabulous Arsenal move. Vieira surging forward. He looked for Wiltord, who scored five times already this season. But Kiley showed what excellent form he's in right now. Luzhny is Vieira. Can he find Bergkamp? He can. Pulls it back. Henri! What a fantastic goal! from Thierry Henry, last season's Golden Boot winner, with an absolute scorcher that ripped into the net past Dean Kiely. The Arsenal scoring record continues. The 45th straight game they've scored in. It sets a new record for top flight football in this country. And what a peach it is. Oh, Williams. Yule can turn. Jason Yule. Lisby, can he reach it? He couldn't. Johansson was in the middle. Here is Lisby. Johansson! And his scoring drought continues. Yule, this is more promising from Charlton. Teasing it in, Seaman. Great goalkeeping. Commanding the area. And a nice little roll out for Edu. Can Arsenal hit them on the break? Vieira's making a run down the left. Can Edu see him? Here he is, it's Vieira. Passing to Wiltord, can he finish it? He can! Silva Wiltord scores his sixth goal of the season. It's classic Arsenal on the break, and it's 2-0 to the champions. Kanu. Trying to get away from Fortune, Henri. Edu's unmarked in the middle, if Henri can find the ball, he's looking for him, here's Edu! Oh, fabulous goal, absolutely beautifully executed. Edu gets his first goal of the season, and Henri's cross from the left-hand side was absolutely inch-perfect.
I've said to my players, you know, some games you play and, you know, you've got to take it on the chin, and we've got to take that on the chin today because we've been beat by a tremendous side. There's no two ways about that. And, you know, a team that if they don't win the league and if they don't perhaps do very well in the Champions League, then that will be a major disaster for them because they're entitled to do very well in both competitions this year.
Fernandes with the corner then for Southampton, who have plenty forward. And one of them's Tetson, and off the line by Powell. In the right place at the right time. At least six in the wall of various colours. It's Jensen who strikes it. Fabulous save by Niemi. Well, that's why Paul Jones can't get in the side. It was a terrific effort from Klaus Jensen. And an even better save to keep it out. Really struck it sweetly.
Him into Giggs, onto Scholes, beautifully worked. Ooh, denied on the goal line by Richard Rufus. Paul Scholes almost marking his comeback with a goal. Beautifully worked goal, it would have been two, but four marks to Rufus in behind his goalkeeper, Kiely. September didn't start very well for Manchester United either, but in the last 10 days they have won three games. Robinson. To Bartlett, no flag, chance here for Sean Bartlett, saved by the right foot of Fabian Barthez, who was exposed there as Charlton Athletic broke quickly. Sean Bartlett, who marked his home debut with a couple of goals against Manchester United a couple of years back, was definitely onside, but Barthez got his angles right. United left back for the moment is one Fabian Barthez, moving up into midfield. O'Shea and Ferdinand rather got in each other's way. Barthez is making his way back. The crowd urging John Fortune to try his luck from 80 yards or so. It's a better alternative. Another game run by Robinson. Linking up with Jensen. He's all alone here, Klaus Jensen. Oh, he doesn't need anybody. Fantastic individual goal by Klaus Jensen. And Charlton Athletic's first goal in nearly a month is against Manchester United. Overdue, but overjoyed. Well, Jensen had no choice. There wasn't another red shirt in sight. Once he'd been fed by John Robinson, he had to go it alone. but he had the ability to drift wide of Ferdinand and then steer an early shot wide of Barthez. He scored a marvellous individual goal against Arsenal last season, and now he scored one against Manchester United, who trail at the Valley. Solskjaer's flick. Giggs. Scholes is forward. Giggs into Scholes! Comeback goal for Paul Scholes. Comeback by Manchester United. It's 1-1. Three teams that have won here this season are all in the top four of the Premiership table this morning. Some consolation for Alan Kirbishley, knowing that he's only got to face the eighth place team today. Is Van Nistelrooy breaking clear? Real opportunities. Ryan Giggs is waltz past Kylie and taking his time to pick his spot and maybe, maybe win this match for Manchester United. Has to come back to Kishishev. Headed down by Bartlett, but headed out by Bartlett, and Manchester United can break, and they outnumber Charlton on this break. It's Solskjaer, it's all to his right. Giggs has stayed onside. Van Nistelrooy's there, Scholes is there, Solskjaer's there. It's going to be Van Nistelrooy. It is 3-1 to Manchester United. 3 second-half goals have done the trick. Ruud van Nistelrooy has come from the substitutes bench to score the third of them, having set up the second themselves. Giggs just onside there. Charlton overcommitted in their attempts to chase the game. Have the game snatched cruelly away from them by two Manchester United goals inside the final 10 minutes. It's another comeback victory in London for Van Nistelrooy and company.
I couldn't see the win coming for them. Perhaps they got on top in the second half and perhaps you couldn't see us winning it, but I couldn't see us getting beat. And the manner we've been beat does hurt.
In what respect?
Well, I don't think, you know, if you're playing against these sides, these top sides, you can't gift them goals. And I think we gifted them their first two goals. And, you know, the last one's irrelevant, I think, 91st, 93rd minute. We sent everyone up for a set play. But you can't gift goals like we did. We have to score great goals against these sort of clubs. And that's our downfall today.
Things hit rock bottom in the first week of October. Embarrassed by third division Oxford and out of the Worthington Cup on penalties. Then there was daylight robbery by the man in the mask away to Fulham. How did the Addicts lose this one?
Mel Bronk. Oh, Cardi's lost it, and Saga has put it in. 35 minutes gone. Fulham take the lead. And what on earth is he doing here, the Argentinian? Some kind of in-joke, I think, that it's one for Zorro, two for Joy for Fulham. And the man behind the mask is Facundo Saba. In stoppage time at the end of the first half. Charlton pressing for that equaliser. The header back safely collected by Van der Sar. Can't be too much to add on, I don't think. But what's Van der Sar done? He's given it straight to Robinson. And now Bartlett must score. He's given it back to Robinson. And Van der Sar saves. And now you're with the shot. Absolute comedy of errors. And somehow Fulham survive. Just an absolute aberration. Rolled it straight to Robinson. He was aiming, I think, for Brevin. Bartlett surely would have been better going for goal himself. Good play again from York. And this is Bartlett for Charlton. Off the crossbar. And it's just not going to go for them. Fulham scramble it away. The South African can't believe it. He was onside, a perfect pass. And a coat of paint prevented it being 1-1. Last few minutes now, time running out. It's in towards Bartlett again. And a combination of goalkeeper and all the post has kept it out. How many chances have Charlton had? In fact, it was just the woodwork.
Alan, a fair result?
No, I don't think so. I think we've dominated most of the game and missed some clear-cut chances. And, you know, even the clear-cut chances, apart from that, we had some others which, you know, if we'd have made the right decision, you know, we had four or five glorious chances here today and didn't score, and you're going to get punished.
Charlton received a timely boost ahead of the Middlesbrough match with the return of Scott Parker and Gary Rowett. It was time to stand up and be counted. Another home defeat was unthinkable, and Charlton had slumped to the bottom of the league just 24 hours before.
Klaus Jensen is eyeing up the possibilities. Doesn't go the direct route, but it's in, and Yule has given Charlton the lead inside 5 minutes.
What a start. A lovely, lovely goal. Super delicate free kick. And a fantastic header from Jason Yule.
And it's just about muscling them out. They're marked really, really tightly. Nothing wrong with the marking at all. You can't get any tighter than this. Is that Hugo Ekio?
Well, I just wonder whether Yule did get the... Yeah, he did. Yeah. It might have been another touch off Ekio as well, but it's Jason Yule's goal. Jeremy only played it against Powell. Parker, some space to move into. A lot of space, he's still going.
Lovely run. I think the ball's a little too central in his stance here when he tries to hit it. I think if he'd been able to shift it further to his right-hand side, Martin, he might have got better purchase. He's a little bit straight on. Never really threatening the goal when he just starts spinning it right to left, away from goal. Lovely run, that's what he's capable of. That's what they've missed in many respects this season, Charlton up till now.
Jensen, good angle for Robinson. Yule, good stop by Schwarzer. In comes Powell. And Ekiog slid across. Charlton so close to the second goal. Powell. On for Parker. Comes out to Powell again. That's Bartlett. Oh. Just needed a touch from Robinson. Greening. Well, parried it away and then onto the outside of the post and behind for a corner.
Well, he gets a bit fortunate, I think, the goalkeeper here. It's a lovely strike, but having got both hands to it, you do think that he might have pushed it a little bit further away. Seems to get through them.
Charlton are off the bottom. Thanks to their first home win since March, their first home points this season. Jason Yule in the fifth minute. Who'd have thought when he scored it, it would win the game? But Charlton were strong enough and organised enough, and Middlesbrough, it has to be said, were off the pace enough for that to happen. Middlesbrough had made an impression this season, a good one. But it is their third away defeat in their last four games on their travels. A much more cheerful Charlton Athletic. Charlton 1, Middlesbrough 0.
We were always on the front foot. We never really let them get too much of a, you know, a pattern of play going. We tried to snuff everything out. You know, we were tight in midfield. We tried to be tight at the back. And the forwards did fantastically well as well. You know, they took a lot of pressure off us by holding it up. And although we didn't score another goal, you know, we looked as though we could have done, which is something that perhaps we haven't done lately. So, you know, it was a good performance all round.
From the soles of his boots to one of the safest pairs of hands in the Premiership, Dean Kiely of Charlton Athletic is a goalkeeper who's found it's taken him years to become an overnight sensation. Salford-born Kiely made his debut in 1990 for Little York City. He went on to make 210 league appearances over 6 years in a long apprenticeship.
York offered me a chance to go and show people what I could do. And my time there was, it was a good grounding, a good base for me, and I played a lot of games there, and it gave me a lot of experience in a short space of time.
Humble Gig Lane was the next port of call. He played 137 games for Bury and kept 19 clean sheets in a season, even though the club were relegated.
Bury came along, I was out of contract, and Stan Turner phoned me up and said he'd amassed a side that he thought could get promotion out of the second division, and it was one player short, and that was a goalkeeper, and he wanted the goalkeeper to be me. Very flattered by it, and true to his word, I went, and in the first season we went up as champions.
But Kiely always had ambitions of playing at the top level, and his dream took a step nearer reality in 1999 when Charlton Athletic, who'd been following his career closely, signed him for £1 million.
For me, it was a chance to join a club that from day one were just saying they'd come out of the Premier League and were saying we're going straight back there. And again, true to their word, Alan Kirbishley and Mervyn Day put me in a side that was very successful, and we went up as champions into the Premier League.
So Kiely was 30 by the time he reached the Premiership, keeping 9 clean sheets in an excellent debut season.
Obviously, what I was being asked to do was perform in one of the best leagues in the world. I'd come up all the way through the divisions, I played in every division, and now, or then, was the ultimate test, what I could do. Could I sort of perform at that level? And standing here now, I feel that I have done. I feel comfortable in the level. I don't feel out of my depth, and I feel experienced and, like I say, comfortable playing in the Premier League week in, week out.
Sheer hard work and a determination to succeed has had its rewards.
The best quality, I think, that I would say that Dino has is consistency. He has a level of performance which very, very, very rarely drops below excellent.
I like to think that when I'm given the jersey on a Saturday afternoon, I like to think that people know what they're going to get from me, and so players can rely and depend on me. And like I say, standing here now, I think that's the level I've achieved and the standard I've set, I think.
Dean Kiely is not a superstar. He's just a very good, no-nonsense goalkeeper. And that's just the way he and Charlton like it.
Muster. Fish. Jensen. Towards Yule, headed out by O'Brien. Bartlett has broken Bramble's challenge, and Sean Bartlett has scored for Charlton. Sheer strength of body and purpose here from Sean Bartlett to crunch through Titus Bramble, make himself a yard, and use that yard to finish. Away as far as Jenis, nudged forward for Shearer, touch back for Griffin, oh! Screamer! Fantastic goal from Andy Griffin, and as hard as Charlton worked to deal with the genuine goal threat of Shearer and Amiobi, they could not deal with that. Solana, Amiobi, Laura Robert, 2-1! Searing, spearing finish from the Frenchman. And Newcastle United have come from behind to lead.
11 games gone and Charlton hovered dangerously just above the bottom three. By November, Charlton's players and fans were just getting used to a very original warm-up routine introduced by the team's South African connection.
So our national team is called Bafana Bafana. That means the boys in Zulu, and Zulus like dancing. So I would say when you're dancing and you're doing a warm-up together, you start getting your body and mind all in sync with each other. Ever since we started doing it, we had a really good run, and fortunately, we're still with the the warm-up, and obviously it's something that the fans have taken to. Some of my teammates are getting better and better. Some of them aren't taking a lot longer than the rest of them to get better, i.e. Kevin Lisby. But no, I think it's something that I've known for nearly all my professional career. So it's something that I enjoy doing, and it's nice to see that my teammates also enjoy doing it.
Yes, November was to prove a hugely significant month, with fortunes changing very much for the better, but not straight away.
Slewed out by Rufus. White made it his. Musto. Caught by Thirlwell. Shots on for McCann. And for Flo. What a shot. Sunderland lead at the Valley. Torre, Andre, Flo. Into service, putting a smile on Howard Wilkinson's face. Rufus sensibly playing it the way he was facing. He was facing Chris Bat. Fisher stayed forward. Ewell! Well, they were queuing up to put it in, and the man who did it was Gary Rowett. It is 1-1.
Well, Rowett and Robinson all. Both of them so happy about the ball because both went for it. They just don't get to the header. They're a little deep. Oh, it's very, very close, isn't it? Robinson really close, I think, to being offside as this is struck across the face of the goal. It is Rowett, I think, who gets the final touch. As it comes in, Rowett's the one who lunges at it. Batchel wants offside. It's a very, very close call.
Jensen. Fischer-Chef, Jensen, Ewell, flag is up.
Tell you what, that's close as well, you know. Harvick Gray are the ones who are away from the play here. As this little one comes through here, I don't think he's off. In fact, he isn't. Ricky Gray was definitely playing him, he was definitely level.
Over the last five games, I've seen a steady improvement. We shouldn't have got beat here by Man United. Got done in the last couple of minutes. Should have got something at Fulham. Beat Middlesbrough here. May have got something last week at Newcastle, and we deserve what we got here today, perhaps even a little bit more. So the last five games, we haven't picked up too many points, but we have been in with a shout of picking more up, which is obviously a good sign for us.
Yobo's header. Ainsworth. Oh, he's been caught out here. Chance. And blasted wide by Musto. Maybe could have taken an extra touch. It's a mistake by first Yobo and then Unsworth. Robbie Musto decided to blast it and it came off the side of the boot. Musto. Gravison nipping it at him and coming away with the ball. And now this is Radzinski! 1-0 Everton. It's the Canadian international Thomas Radzinski that's broken the deadlock just past the half-hour mark. For Ewell. Ewell's knocked down, Lisby! How far away was that? It was well cushioned down, under pressure by Ewell. Lisby with one swing, it's close, not close enough. It's been the story of Charlton's game and season so far. Well, here comes the wonder kid. He's scored against Leeds, he's scored against Arsenal. Can Charlton withstand the wonder of Rooney? Here's Rooney. And Powell, Everton wanted a foul against Rooney. He was charging in here and that's wild. That's really wild from the 17-year-old. And Chris Powell is trying to do the youngster a favour here. He's appealing for no card to be shown. I think there will be at least a yellow. And this is why, oh, he didn't make contact, but the intent was there. Across the signal and now delivers. And Schmeichel is hemmed in, and Gary Rowett was so close to putting Charlton in front. And the big defender feels he should have done. Rowett with a wonderful run, and it was so open for him. that's Yule. And he's won it back. And it's chipped forward now towards Johansson. And Johansson has Yule in the middle. Yule's missed it. Bartlett might not. Sean Bartlett scores for Charlton. Finally, the pressure has told. Johansson gave chase gamely. Yule might have missed it, but Bartlett wasn't about to. His second goal of the season. Good chip over the top from Radostin Kishishev. Even better awareness from Johansson. Alan Kirvishley wants to hear the whistle as much as the travelling fans. And there it is. Charlton Athletic end a run of five away games without a win with their priceless 3 points at Main Road. It's finished. Manchester City 0, Charlton Athletic 1.
I think it will be a huge lift. I think it's very fortunate. Every time we come to Man City, we manage to turn our season around. So hopefully we can get a couple of wins on a spin and get ourselves out of the bottom half.
So far this season, I think we've been outplayed once. And that was by Arsenal, and that was in the last 25 minutes. And the rest of the games, we've been in with a shout. Haven't picked up enough points. Let's hope it's the start of something today.
Quick feet from Kishishev. Parker of similar ability. He was pursued by Todd. And in the end, in the mind of Uriah Rennie, tripped by Todd.
Well, I think it's just a little push, isn't it? As much as anything, Martin gets hold of the shot. He almost tripped over his own feet. Mm.
Still in the first quarter of an hour of the second half. Uriah Rennie makes sure that a bit of pushing and shoving at the end of that wall is under his control. Not satisfied as yet. They're trying to create a gap, I think, for maybe Konchesky to whip the ball through. There it goes.
There it goes!
Paul Konchesky, substitute for Charlton. A sensational arrival into the match. He's made the breakthrough.
Well, maybe the manager's made the breakthrough. Great change at half-time. But what a weekend it's been for free kicks, Martin. And glorious free kicks that have just been unstoppable. This is another one that's in that bracket. Just open the top drawer and put this one in amongst the rest. Hamann Shearer to quote another two this weekend. A quite stunning free kick from Paul Konchesky.
You were a little down on yourself for your predictions yesterday, Andy, about that tight game at Old Trafford, but I must say you said about set pieces very early in the piece today.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I think if you keep it tight at the back, the way that they've done, Charlton, don't concede, then, all right, if you're not creating chances, then you pay special attention to free kicks, corners, and you might just nick one. I wouldn't say that was nicking one. It was a glorious free kick. But it's given them a valuable, valuable lead, Charlton.
Thompson! The lead hasn't lasted for long. It's zipped in past Dean Kiely from David Thompson. It was an inviting ball. Kevin Lisby, who's got the velocity to get into those situations, that's not easy. He just hasn't got that killer instinct.
This is a brilliant cross from Jason Newell. I think he should head this. I think if he throws himself at that, it's a much easier skill. He should still hit the target. That's a glorious opportunity. You won't get a better ball, you won't get a better chance.
Another dead ball situation for Paul Konchesky. Charlton corner this time. Oh, Rufus, free header! Makes the most of it. Charlton lead for a second time. Richard Rufus. Another set piece for Alan Kirvishley's team.
No one on the post. And they pay the price, Blackburn. And this is just good movement from Rufus. He goes in, he watches movement, and then he checks back in behind his marker. And by doing that, he doesn't have to jump, Martin. He's made the little movement. He's got himself the yard of space he needs. And then he just directs the header. It's a fabulous header over Alan Kelly. There's a run. There's the check. He's lost Lucas Neal, I think it is. And that's a fabulous header. When you stick someone on the goalpost, you're heading it clear. Two minutes away from a big, big victory.
Knocked down by Bartlett. Ewell trying to wrap it up. Oh! What a wonderful way to do just that. The points are in the bag now for Alan Kerbishlik and Charlton Athletic.
Well, the goals just keep getting better and better. He's deserved that. He's been Charlton's best player. He's been all over this pitch. Defence, midfield, attack. What a strike this is. Absolutely flies past Alan Kelly. It's close to the goalkeeper, but he can't do anything about it, man, because the power is absolutely stunning. What a strike. He's deserved it.
Victories in the Barclay Card Premiership for Charlton Athletic. That hasn't happened since the turn of the year. The only side in the bottom five at the start of the weekend to have won, to have gained a bit of breathing space. Tony Blackburn second away defeat in the league, and the first time they have lost anywhere to Charlton Athletic in the Premiership. Charlton 3, Blackburn 1.
Been playing a bit deeper. Do you enjoy playing back there a little bit more?
Yeah, sometimes, you know, you get a bit more of the bullpen and how the game goes, and he asked me against Man City just to do a bit because Klaus is injured, and I really enjoy it in there as well as I like playing up front. But you know, once it helps the team and gets points on the table, that's all that matters.
Results breed confidence, and I'm sure now they're gonna come in full of beans this week and looking forward to the games. I know we haven't been that down, but it does help when you get some results, and they've been digging in for the last 3 or 4 weeks, and you know they've deserved to turn it around. You know, can we carry on now?
Oh, this is clever play and a terrific save. Robinson had to make that save as well, because there was certainly plenty of venom in the effort there from Kevin Lisby, who flips the ball over Woodgate. Clever centre-forward play. And a fierce shot which Robinson had to deal with. Yes. Picking up now, and Kewell's on his way here. He's got a man left, it's Kewell, he's going to go for goal! Is he going to go for goal or what? Terrific stuff from the Australian. His attitude has been in question, not from his manager, I hasten to add. Harry Kewell thumps the air. It's his 8th goal of the season. He's Leeds United's leading scorer now. And through the middle he went with one thing on his mind. Eluded Luke Young and belted it wide of Dean Kiely. And Leeds preciously have the first goal of a tense afternoon at Elland Road.
Corner for Leeds, who lead by a goal to nil from Hart. Kewell. Plenty of time here for Lisby to clear Charlton lines. Jensen. Then Parker. Then it will be Rowett's ball up here. Dewberry has to take care of this. It's dropped in. Great chance here. Lisby! Equaliser! Charlton level with Kevin Lisby's first goal of the season, and Terry Venable shrugs his shoulders, puts his hands on his hips and wonders how on earth he's going to get a victory at the moment. Kevin Lisby has struck a dagger into the hearts of Leeds United. He had all the time in the world, and he bounced his shot wide of Paul Robinson. Here it is, down into the ground, wide of the flailing arm of the Leeds United goalkeeper, and it's Leeds 1, Charlton 1.
90 seconds. That is all. What an important 90 seconds, perhaps, for Terry Venables. Smith glances ahead, and the shot! Well, that really does sum up the Leeds luck at the moment. Terrific try from Michael Bridges, and it flew off the upright and stayed out. Kewell loses the possession. Parker forward. This is Charlton's opportunity. Still Parker. Can he finish? He can! Would you believe it? Would you believe it? Terry Venables slumps to his seat, and Scott Parker may have won the day for Charlton Athletic here against a distraught Leeds United who simply cannot believe what is happening to them in life right now. Parker took them all on beyond Woodgate, slipped it wide of Robinson, but you have to say the challenges were futile, and Scott Parker has perhaps won a famous victory at Elland Road for Charlton Athletic. Their first ever against Leeds in the Premier League. And it just goes from bad to worse for Terry Venables and Leeds United.
There's one of them again with me. I run through and end up the end product's not the best. But today it turned a little bit for me. I had one in the first half, and then second half I've just gone through and just toe-poked it in. So it's very pleasing. I've just come at an angle and it seemed to just really... I've been clipped on the ankle. I was not sure if to go down. I stayed on my feet and just poked it in.
This is not going to be the end of the Charlton run, is it? Are we going to see more of you?
No, I think so. I think, you know, if you was in the changing rooms tonight after this game, you'll see the spirit in the lads, and you'll see it around the training ground. It's a great spirit, and I'm sure we can go and climb the table now.
The transformation of Charlton Athletic Football Club and the restoration of its beloved home has been nothing short of miraculous. The Valley is now a first-class 21st century sporting arena. This is a forward-thinking club now, but as the 10th anniversary of Charlton's historic return to SE7 approached, it was time to look back, remember the struggles of years before, and remind yourself of just what has been achieved.
Although we wasn't well supported at Sellhurst Park and Upton Park, you know, they never gave up. They never gave up the fact that we was going to get back to the Valley.
I think lesser fans may have given up the ghost long before and just accepted things weren't going to be the way they used to be, and a part of history would be lost, you know. That didn't happen.
We were all on our hands and knees clearing those terraces. There was trees springing up in the middle of the pitch and everything else. Oh, there was a big involvement as well. Many, many fans down there.
Great atmosphere. Win, lose or draw, I don't think any fan would really care that day. The whole objective was us going through those gates. But I think the emotion of the day just took over every single person that came to that game.
There's absolutely no way that Portsmouth were going to win that day. It was our game, it was our day. We went on and got a 1-0 result. The joy on everybody's faces. The next time I saw that was when we actually gained promotion.
We'd lose people like Scott Minto, Robert Lee in particular, that I remember. And, you know, that was very, very costly at the time, because probably it meant during the early 90s, mid-90s, perhaps we could have had a real chance of promotion. And we lost someone like Robert Lee, who was a key player.
It had to be done. There was no other way. There was lots of sacrifices being made at the time. Getting back to the Valley was more important probably than us ever gaining promotion, because getting back to the Valley enabled us to be a football club again. We wasn't a football club, you know, we was playing at other people's grounds, lost a generation of fans to other London clubs, if you like. We was never going to be a football club again until we got back to the Valley. And I think we can call ourselves a football club now.
Colin Walsh proudly led out the teams on a truly magnificent day against Liverpool. And just like 10 years before, Charlton lived up to the occasion.
Chesky's free kick. Ooh, and Chris Kirkland had to deal with it. Everybody was expecting the ball to be placed onto the head of one of the defenders. But instead, it was almost placed into the top corner of Chris Kirkland's goal. Quick feet from the 6 feet, 6 inch Liverpool goalkeeper. Bartlett, Parker, Ewell. Now Rout. Kishishev. Won by Rowett for Lisby. Rowett's cross. Ewell's there. Good defending by Carragher, but Ewell with the second time of asking. Charlton lead with a goal from Jason Ewell. Denied initially by some very stout defending. Ewell was alert enough and light on his feet to respond. Jamie Carragher did enough against him, but it came back off Onsho. And Ewell whipped it into the top corner. And Charlton Athletic have won all three games in which Jason Ewell has scored previous to this one. Given away by Fish. Reese's cross, in towards Diouf! Terrific stop by Kiley, might come for Michael Owen! Rufus got to him, well the real hero there was Dean Kiley. It was a fantastic chance for El Hadj Diouf, although Kiley's reactions were good, the header was straight at him. Rowett. In towards Bartlett, it'll come for Lisby, and Bartlett! Well, the next goal in this match is going to be all important. If Charlton could possibly give themselves some breathing space, Liverpool's task would be more than doubled. Michael Owen, El Hadj Diouf, Michael Owen, hit in by Barros, and he's offside. Goal won't count. Now, was Michael Owen's shot goal-bound anyway? And if Barros had left it, would it have counted? Diouf and Owen with the setup. Owen with a scuff shot. Barros is clearly beyond the last defender. And his final touch was the touch that was penalised. For all Gerard Houllier's complaints, the decision was a correct one. Risa, here is Owen. Murphy. Eased off the ball by Konchesky. Konchesky again. Now Lisby. Possibilities here on the counter. Bartlett. Oh, good stop by Kirkland. Here's Lisby again. And Konchesky! Yes! Coolly taken by Paul Konchesky. It's Charlton Athletic 2, Liverpool 0. They've always looked dangerous on the break. They have been under siege at times in this second half. But Charlton have continued to believe they could find a way past Chris Kirkland again. And Paul Konchesky with the most delightful of lobbed finishes has given the home side clear daylight. Happy anniversary, Charlton Athletic. A famous day is crowned by a famous win. A goal in either half from Jason Ewell and Paul Konchesky. Liverpool have become 1 point from the last 15. They are in a rotten run. But Charlton Athletic have won four times in a row in the Premiership for the first time. And it is a happy, happy valley today. Final score, Charlton Athletic 2, Liverpool 0. It's funny, it was said 10 years ago there could only be one result, the crowd will Charlton to victory. There was an element of that today.
I think so, yeah. And it was mentioned in the dressing room before the game and at half time that, you know, this is a celebration day, if you like. And, you know, the fans, I think, showed that from the first minute. They was cheering everything.
Come a long way, haven't you?
We have. Chairman's talking about Europe now. And oh, no, it's just pleasing. We had a bad start to the season, lots of problems, and we've got ourselves back on track, and hopefully, as I've said all along, you know, we can compete in this league. I'm not saying that we're top six or top ten, but I think the squad's strong enough to compete in this league, and that's good enough for me.
Now it's four successive wins. Charlton are loving every second of their best ever Premiership run.
I've come up from a young boy and I've seen different players come and go, really, and at the moment I think this is the best squad we've had here and the manager has had to pick from.
As a young player at this club, you realise that you got a chance, and that was the same with me, you know, when I signed at 9 years of age, and coming back from Lillishaw, I always knew that I thought if I progressed right and got my head around things that I would get a chance here.
Six of the squad rose through the ranks, so it's a tight unit. Parker and Konchesky first made the team at 16. Then for years they were used sparingly. Nurturing his talented, ambitious youngsters has been a tricky balance for the boss.
I'd like to think that when they're the right age, I think 22 probably is the right age, that when they get to 22, they can go in our side and stay in there for 10 years. Not come in at 17, 18, 19 and then disappear at 24. That's not the idea of it.
It came to when a stage of my career where I thought maybe I have to start pushing on, and really I just asked if I could go out on loan, and Kerbs agreed to that, and looking back now, it was probably the best thing I ever did, really.
My brother-in-law's brother is John Terry, and he had a good year last year, but this year he cannot get in the team, and for me, that's good for me, knowing that at Charlton Athletic, it might be a smaller club, people think they are, but I've been playing week in, week out, and I've been involved.
They honestly think they should have been in my side a lot earlier, and you know, there's nothing wrong in that, but I have to make the decisions, and you know, I'm sure that when we come down to it, I'll be proved right.
Yeah, it was probably a bit right.
Parker's had the hardest task, replacing Mark Kinsella, but the 22-year-old's playing so well, he might soon be allowed to forget he was once that ball-juggling kid in the burger advert. Soon, but not just yet.
You really want to get known for what you're doing on the pitch and get rewarded for that, and not so much you score a goal and suddenly it's burger this, burger that. And hopefully now people are starting to sit back and reward me for that.
How far can Charlton go, do you think, with this current bunch of players coming through?
Yeah, I think we've got a great chance. Maybe not this year, but I think we can push up the table and be the top half of the league. We're not a little club like people think we are.
Paul's talking top five already, you know.
Yeah, is he really? Well, I don't know, you know, I think maybe that's a bit ambitious for us, but I feel as a team and as a squad, as a manager and the staff behind that, we've got some good grounding.
We've looked back and, you know, can we look forward now and yeah, get rid of the plucky little Charlton and become Charlton, yeah, they're a decent Premiership side.
Lisby, he's got between two defenders, penalty. It was Kevin Horlock who brought him down. Now Charlton have a penalty kick and Horlock could be in trouble. He has already been booked. Just a question of how David Pugh sees this. Just inside the area. The referee was in a decent position, you see him there. But Horlock, by the look of it, has got away with it from a personal point of view. David Pugh has not produced a card. And this, in fact, is Charlton's first penalty since the second game of the season. That was away at Bolton. Horlock is a lucky man. He stays on, but his team could well be about to go a goal down if Jason Yule can keep his cool from 12 yards. And he can. Very impressively tucked into the corner by Charlton's top scorer. 5-0 for the season for Jason Yule. It needed a goal, and it's come just 6 minutes after half-time. Schmeichel went the wrong way. Very confidently done. Charlton have a free kick, which Rowett is going to take. They've got plenty forward here, Charlton, as well. That's Luke Young. Leesby's chest, that's Jensen! 2-0 Charlton, and it has been coming. Been a really impressive spell for the Addicts. Nothing Schmeichel could do about it. It was perfectly placed by the Dane to beat his fellow countrymen and give Charlton Athletics some breathing space. Headed back in by Young, it was a clever chest by Leesby, and just passed into the corner, really, by Klaus Jensen. His third of the season. Just can't keep possession, Manchester City. They've given it away again. And Leesby is on the charge again. He's onside. He's got past Howie, he's gone down in a heap, and past Dunn. Leesby must be, and Schmeichel sticks out a leg. Jensen, too high. Well, that would have sealed it, without any question. It was terrific play from Leesby initially. It had everything but the finish. He left Steve Howie in a heap. How's that for a piece of skill? And he just couldn't get it past big Peter Schmeichel. Real touch for Ali Benabia. Just came off Rabbit's head, and that's Foley! And it's in! Kylie got a piece of it, but he couldn't keep it out, and City are back in the game. Berkovic, Anelka. Oh, Rufus with a challenge, surely a penalty, and the referee says no. And Anelka looks at David Pugh with an expression of disbelief, and Richard Rufus has got away with what looked, on first impression, a cast-iron penalty kick. Just 4 minutes left, City have a corner, they are pressing for an equaliser. Away by Bartlett, only as far as Berkovic, Vivian Foley! And they have got their equaliser! And they have deserved it in truth! Two now for Mark Vivian Foe, while Keegan said he wanted him to get forward and score more goals. And the Cameroonian has taken him at his word. 87 minutes on the clock. And we're all tied up at 2-2.
Now, Steve Brown never let anyone down at Charlton, but with his first team opportunities diminishing, he left for Reading. Steve gave this football club more than 10 years sterling service, whatever position he played in.
What a diving stall again by Brown. And so Brown is starting to take on heroic status at the back now for Charlton.
Sheely's shot. Oh, well saved. Well taken, Steve Brown. Half a chance. Tries the shot. Good save. Another one.
This is his club, his moment. And he is sure enough as well. Brown. Good hit from Brown. Oh, it's another spectacular goal.
Hurried throw straight at Konchesky, in point of fact. Now Jensen. Parker. Jensen kept moving. It's Klaus Jensen. Oh, clever feet, clever finish. Lovely, lovely goal. Splendid 1-2 between Jensen and Parker, after which it was all the Danes' work. And Charlton are ahead at St Andrews. Beautiful lightness of feet, made a fool of the goalkeeper and filled an empty net. Horsfield's got in really hard on Luke Young there, and the Charlton defender has come out worse from that 50-50 challenge, and Horsfield could find himself in a little trouble here, a lot of trouble. Studs were showing, and studs did damage to Luke Young, and Jeff Horsfield has rightly been sent off. Savage spreading it for Devlin. Can run at Parker and can run at Powell and feed it in for Cisse. And Cisse's got over Jensen and the referee has given a penalty. Paul
Sean Devlin, with a quarter of the match to play, equalises. Top corner, really efficient. Birmingham 1, Charlton 1.
Rufus letting it run through to Mark Fish. Now on by Parker. Now Lisby could be away here. He's got Jason Yule up with him. And Bartlett as well. Still Lisby. And it'll fall for Yule. And it's there! The opening goal goes to Charlton. And it's Jason Yule with his sixth in the Premiership this season. Inside a quarter of an hour. Tottenham caught on the hop. And it was Jason Yule who fired in an excellent goal. Tottenham were fully extended, and it fell invitingly for Yule after that deflection. Maybe another there that could well have wrong-footed Casey Keller. Nifty footwork though from Lisby, and then Yule. Well, Glenn Hoddle's team finding it hard going so far today. Remember, they have already won at Charlton this season. Alan Kerbyshire's team with the upper hand on this occasion. Jensen. On by Lisby, and it's Jason Yule in pursuit. Out comes Keller. But Yule is there again, and it's two. Jason Yule has doubled Charlton's money. 4 minutes into the second half. Another poacher's goal from Yule. Keller committed here from Jensen's through ball. And then Lisby. Out comes Keller. And he and Perry got caught out then, really. And Yule nips in to score. It did fall kindly for him. He wasn't going to miss from there. And Tottenham at the moment are in deep trouble. Ziga. Hit long towards Iversen. And then Robbie Keane to smack it home. And Tottenham are back in this game. Halfway through the second half. A lifeline for them. Another deep ball in for Charlton to deal with, and they have it. It's Stefan Iversen. It's 2-2. What a glorious back post header then. Keane. Again, he's in threatening mood. So is Davis. Off the line, Iversen, and Richard Rufus somehow got back there to turn it away. Goodness me, the transformation was almost complete then. Richard Rufus on the line. This was Simon Davis, good stop by Kylie, and it was Richard Rufus to the rescue.
I think we're mainly disappointed because the last three games, we've been in the lead, 2-0 against Man City with 15 minutes to go, 1-0 against Birmingham, and just not... You know, gone on and won the game, so it's something that we've got to obviously improve on.
Klaus Jensen then with the early corner for Charlton. Holt didn't make it, and Kevin Lisby did. 5 minutes gone, the best possible start for Charlton Athletic. Kevin Lisby.
8 games unbeaten, the New Year's Day fixture versus West Ham was rained off, leaving Charlton just below halfway in the table. The first fixture of 2003 would be in the FA Cup.
Chris Bart-Williams will take the free kick for Charlton Athletic. Exeter have held firm here for best part of 25 minutes. Towards Bartlett, Johansson, brilliant! The third division club's resistance is broken by some tremendous agility from Jonathan Johansson. Bartlett's flick, and how's that for a finish? Well, they've hardly had a shot in anger, the Grecians, but they have got a free kick here, which Gareth Sheldon is going to take. Floated in towards Gaia, who equalises! Out of nothing! The Charlton won't be happy with the marking, but Exeter won't care, it was a prodigious leap. No chance for Kylie. Rufus. In towards Bartlett again. And Johansson again. And he scored again. Two overhead kicks, two goals. And if anything, That was even better than the first one. Brilliant. Just under 20 minutes left. And here's Yule, with Johansson making a run ahead of him. And he's in space to Finn, and he's taken down by Pilkington, and that has to be a penalty. Very straightforward decision for Phil Dowd to make. No arguments from Exeter City, and it's going to be Jason Yule from 12 yards against Kevin Miller. Oh, he just about squeezed it in, but it'll do. And it's Charlton 3, Exeter City 1.
Then, huge controversy at Chelsea. Following the match, Charlton argued that the sand-based Stamford Bridge pitch constituted an artificial surface and was against the rules. The Premier League launched an inquiry, but ultimately turned down Charlton's request for a replay. Chelsea, though, were still fined. The result stood and the pitch was relayed the very next day. Not very satisfactory, really.
Charlton have won the last two games at Stamford Bridge 1-0. This pitch, however, looks more like Stamford Beach. And by Good Johnson. Here's Lassau. And Hasselbaink. Oh, it's a penalty. Mike Dean, the referee, had absolutely no doubts. It's Jimmy Floyd Hasselbaink against Dean Kiley. And Chelsea are in front after just 3 minutes. Lampard. Now Gronkia. Gallas making a move forward. It's Gallas! Fantastic hit! On by Parker. And here come Chelsea again. There's a break on here, led by Jimmy Floyd Hasselbaink. Gronkia providing magnificent support. Lampard in the middle. So too is Good Johnson. It's Gronkia. And Good Johnson! 3-0. Here's Lampard. Petit in trouble once more. Here's Lisby. Penalty again. Lisby held then by Marcel Desailly. Jason Yule has pulled a goal back. But it's scant consolation at the end of what has been a very disappointing first half for Charlton. Hasselbaink. Now Lassau. Oh, it's gone in! A miserable afternoon gets worse for Charlton. And particularly their goalkeeper, Dean Kiley, now. Seemed a straightforward save, but there was a bit of dip on that shot from Graham Lassau. And the movement in the air possibly deceived the goalkeeper. Here they come again. Lampard away from Parker. Hasselbaink's cross. And Good Johnson in there. Ball still hasn't gone out of play. Good Johnson again. Wonderful save by Kiley. Truly magnificent stop by the Charlton Athletic goalkeeper. How on earth did he get to that header from Good Johnson? Quickly across his goal. Terrific save.
Very disappointing for our fans and everybody else because, you know, I'm sure anyone that's seen us, that is not us. And, you know, very disappointing. None of us can really look forward to seeing it again and, you know, think about, you know, the next game can't come quick enough, really.
Line in there, straight outside the penalty area. Goalkeeper just couldn't quite put the brakes on. Bartlett was being steered wide there by Mike Whitlow. Referee David Ellery got it absolutely right. By Jensen. Fisted clear by Jaskalainen. On by Kishishev. Here's Rufus. And now Fish. The perfect start to the second half for Charlton Athletic. It's a goal from the skipper. And it's a goal against his former club. A goal from Fish is a rarity in itself. It's his first Premiership goal now since April 2001. Yorkaev. Phantom challenge there by Parker. Here's Lisby. And Yule's in the clear. Well, he is now. What a chance for Jason Yule. Mike Whitlow stumbled on the edge of the penalty area. And Yule perhaps couldn't believe his luck. The second goal there would have surely finished Bolton off. Here's Whitlow. Came off Rufus. Back in by Franson. Oh, fantastic goal by Yure Yorkaev. A magnificent effort. And Bolton against all the odds are level. It's one of the goals of the season. But if Bolton were to score, it just had to be Yure Yorkaev. That's his fourth now in three games against Charlton. A terrific effort.
Rearranged from New Year's Day, struggling West Ham were boosted by the signings of former Charlton favourite Lee Bowyer and centre-forward Les Ferdinand from Tottenham. Charlton, though, were up for the challenge. It was a big night for big hearts. It was also a great match.
By Powell, pursued by Parker and by Bowyer, who went in very hard at the back of Scotty Parker and sent him hurtling into the advertising hoardings. And a player once loved on this ground is far from appreciated now for fair charging into the current local hero. That would have hurt Scotty Parker. Again, away from Powell, who then bites back at him, and Parker goes biting in as well. And Parker and Bowyer, not for the first time on the night, are squaring up, and hands are raised, and tempers are flaring. And Eddie Wolstenholme's going to have to take a grip here, just as Parker and Bowyer took a grip on each other. No love lost, no favours for the old boy who is booked, and so is the young hero, Scott Parker. Out by Bowyer, touched on by Defoe, got it back from Cisse. Cisse and Carrick are after it for West Ham. Powell is covering, Rufus getting back. Cisse went for goal, West Ham lead. Edouard Cisse celebrates. It was Richard Rufus, though, tackling back, and either might have got the final touch. Carrick jabbed it forward, and I think it was Rufus who lifted it over Kiely. In a desperate last-gasp tackle, to deny Cisse the goal, but to gift it to West Ham anyway. Well on Bartlett by Christian Daly. And Charlton have a free kick in the last 4 or 5 minutes before half-time now. The Scotsman climbing on the South African. Jensen and Powell together over the set piece. All over it. Jensen at it. Charlton level. The crispest of hits from Klaus Jensen. And David James was grasping at thin air. Curvishly side, all square in the run-up to half-time. Klaus Jensen picking his spot and finding it immaculately.
What a game now. A London derby that has sparked into life. Lifted high by Fish. Taken down by Bartley. Wriggled away from Bowyer. Yule. Parker! 2-1! Smashing move, smashing finish, smashing into the first half for Charlton. And Scotty Parker again is at the centre of it. This little live wire always makes things happen. Jason Yule helped to make things happen, but Parker's first touch was neat, his second was telling, and Charlton have come from behind in four telling minutes before the break. Clever ball from Yule, beautiful take from Parker, it's 2-1. And Glenn Rhoda's strugglers now have a real problem. Alan Kirbishley's buoyant side with a lead they scarcely expected into the start of the second half. Jensen over the free kick. Out as far as Fish, who miskicked. Parker didn't! Charlton have a cushion! Another pure strike from Scotty Parker, leaving David James helpless and Alan Kirbishley with a comfort zone. Daly's header out, Fish's miss, and James partially unsighted perhaps by the crowd of players in front of him, given no chance of getting to Scotty Parker's left-footed hit. One back by Scotty Minto for West Ham. Defoe. Ferdinand pursuing it. Taking on Jensen and getting clear of him. Touchback for Carrick, and it got a deflection, it's in! Trevor Sinclair running away from the piece, Carrick had the original shot. It just might be, though, that it went in off Mark Fish. It was Fish's knee that got the last touch, and incredibly, in a game that Charlton lead 3-2, Charlton have scored all five goals. Oh, you're caught in possession by Johansson. We can run away from Daly. In towards Svensson, and out for Kishishev! Game, set, match! The Bulgarian has sealed it, and Lee Bowyer on what used to be home territory hangs his head. It was his error which led to the confirmation of Charlton's win. Bowyer losing the ball where it is a crime to lose the ball. Johansson taking on Winterburn. Stabbed in by Svensson, out by James, and in tellingly by Radostin Kishishev. And Charlton have a 4-2 lead. Defoe. Out by Rufus. And claimed by Kiley. And the points are claimed by Charlton Athletic at the end of a thrilling London derby. From either end of the Blackwall Tunnel they came. They provided a wonderful match, which was won by telling moments from Scotty Parker and ultimately from Radostin Kishishev. A happy evening for Alan Kirbishley. Problems for Lee Bowyer on what used to be his own home ground. Final score, Charlton 4, West Ham 2.
Local derby full of, you know, what it should be. You know, let's get back to some old-fashioned tackles and the weather. And on top of that, we play some good football.
I think the second one was crucial. I think if we would have gone in at half-time 1-0 down or even 1-1, I think we would have come in a bit disappointed because really, you know, we dominated the game first half and really did not deserve to be 1-0 down after however long, you know, and so it was good that we clawed ourselves back into it.
It's nice, all the midfield players got the midfield players got the goals, and you know, Jason's been playing in and he scored a few goals, and I think we scored there too as well, didn't we? So good night all round.
But it was a case of after the Lord Mayor's show in the fourth round of the FA Cup, as Charlton were beaten again by Fulham. Steed Malbronk scored a hat-trick, including two penalties, all in the second half, as the West Londoners won 3-0 at Loftus Road. The defeat was compounded by the sending off of Mark Fish in conceding the second penalty, which was converted in the last minute. Fortunately, the Addicts soon got back to winning ways in the league at West Brom, by which time Tahar El-Khaledj had been signed on a short-term contract as centre-half cover. He'd have to wait a month for his debut, though.
But a positive start from West Bromwich Albion. This is Jason Kumas, the main playmaker. It's a useful ball in! It's a fantastic save by Kiley. It was Ronnie Woolwork who arrived bang on cue, and he can't believe that Kiley kept it out. Fantastic reaction from the Charlton keeper. Just gets better every time you look at it. Klaus Jensen is over the free kick, for which Charlton have six players inside that West Brom box. Chipped up towards Bartlett, and it's in! It came off a West Brom player, and against the run of play, Charlton have the lead. It was Danny Dicchio it hit last, but it's Bartlett's goal. And a precious one for Charlton. This is Gregan, and a hang it up towards Scott Dobie, and it's come off the post, and Kiley is grateful to grab it. Richard Rufus was in there as well with the West Brom substitute. Not quite sure who it came off last. Like Rufus got the last touch there. Final seconds. Corner to Albion. They've won the header. Johnson! He's put it over from no more than 3 yards out. Unbelievable miss.
Sean has been without a goal for some time, him and Kevin, but they've worked ever so hard for us and caused all sorts of problems and made goals. I was pleased for him that he went in. But it's quite surprised he got a free header because there's so many big boys out there and it's the last thing you expect is a free header. But we've rode our luck a little bit tonight. Great save from Dino, and that could have been a different story. And in all fairness to West Brom, in the two games we played against them, they've put a good show up, they've played well, and they've not deserved us to beat them twice, that's for sure. But that sometimes happens. You know, we're in a good run and they're not.
February kicked off at the Stadium of Light, but if Black Cats are supposed to be lucky, forget it.
Charlton looked a fortune. In by Jensen. Fish. Fortune went up. Mark Fish. Deflected it in! And that sums up Sunderland's luck right now. Not just one deflection, but two. Stephen Wright, the unluckiest man of all. Mark Fish had two bites at it. It hit not one, but two Sunderland players, first off Flo, and then off the right heel of Stephen Wright. No way can Fish claim that. Has to go down as a Stephen Wright own goal. Lisbon, Yule, Jensen, Kevin Lisby, Scott Parker, Chris Powell. This is good play by Charlton. Oh, it's another own goal! Michael Proctor! Twice in 3 minutes! This really is the Stadium of Fright. I can't imagine that even in his 20 years as a league manager on and off, Howard Wilkinson has had one of his teams concede two own goals in the space of 3 minutes. You're next to bottom of the league, you can't buy a win or a goal. Well, Sunderland have scored twice, both in their own net. Jensen to take. Oh, it's got it again! It's another own goal! Michael Proctor for a second time. Three own goals in the space of 7 minutes. Proctor seemed to turn his back on the ball as it came in from Jensen's corner and wasn't actually looking at it as it struck him on the back and beat the hapless Sorensen. And Rufus has got the better of Craddock. Here's Parker. Yule! Well, it would be novel if Charlton were up to actually score a goal themselves. They are 3-0 up, but all three goals have been gifted to them. And that was a fair effort by Yule. Jensen. Powell. Yule. Charlton threatening again. Johansson. Yule! Would have been a picture book goal. Best move of the game, without any doubt at all. Ball delivered first time at some speed. Nice cushioned layoff and Yule just placing it too close to Thomas Sorensen. McCann to Flo. Now, was he taken down? Yes, penalty. A lifeline or merely the opportunity for late consolation for Sunderland. John Fortune clipping Flo's heels. Kevin Phillips to give Sunderland hope. Bullseye! That is real mental strength from the former England striker. Mickey Gray turning into trouble in the form of Scott Parker. And Parker away from Gray could finish matters here and now. That really would have brought him to the nation's attention as Sven-Göran Eriksson ponders his next England squad. Scored a spectacular goal at Leeds. Nearly repeated the dose here.
Could the players believe their luck at half-time?
No, we just even spoke. No, in our warm-down, we just said we couldn't believe they were 3-0 up. We've never been 3-0 up Charlton. So I think it would have put one or two of the, you know, Mr. Kobishly and Mervyn Day, probably they would have been panicking because they've never seen us go 3-0 up. So, yeah, we couldn't believe it, but we knew that they're going to come out fighting in the second half, and obviously they did. But, you know, we stood firm and got the 3 points.
As Charlton's ambitions expand, Jason Yule's stay the same, to learn, improve and represent the nation.
Chris Powell's doing well at Charlton, he got his chance. Wayne Bridge's doing well at Southampton, he got his chance. So I don't think it really matters now what club you're playing for. I think if you're doing well and you're English, then you probably get your chance.
Other fantasies came true, like scoring at Highbury in a Charlton win. Ewell wants to be much more than the man in the mobile phone ad. That's one reason he left Wimbledon, where they always knew he was special, even as a precocious kid.
The players used to call you King.
Yeah, that was just something that started in the reserves where I started playing as first year pro and scoring a lot of goals and things like that. And I think when Joe called me into the squad, I think like a lot of players just called me King and the saviour and things like that. So just probably an in-house joke where he just got a bit blown out of proportion.
I asked Robbie Earle to sum you up actually, and he said he's a poor man's Paul Scholes, is how I describe him.
I'm probably just looking at the size of the clubs, really, you know, in that way. The fact that he's put me in the sort of same category as Paul Scholes, I'll definitely take the compliment. So it's just how Robbie's got his way of saying things, a different one, but, you know.
If you're going to be king of the dressing room here, it's about time you brought Chris Powell down to earth and join him with an England cap.
Yeah, you know, it's one of those things where it's not just myself, which is probably looking at that. You know, there are English players in the club who are all doing well, Paul Konchesky, Scott Parker. You know, but it's one of those when you think, if it happens, it happens. It don't, just carry on doing what you're doing.
There are no big-time Charlies at the Valley, and Ewell's certainly not the type. Sport is his focus, but not his life. 15 months ago, while his partner was in labour, their baby daughter died.
You look at life in a different perspective, you know. It's just not all about football and all the material things that are out there, you know. It is one of those things you never thought it would happen to you, you know, and you never want to wish it on anyone else as it has happened to you. So you look at life and think, well, there is a lot more to it and you've got to take it each day by day. When I first started at 18 playing pro, you think, well, I've got to hopefully a long career in it, but I mean, it does go quite quick. And look at it now, it's like 8 years down the line now, so it's one of those when you think to yourself, well, just you've got to go and grab it now.
Stubbs comes across, and it's fallen here for Chris Pearce. Long towards Bartlett, and Leite is in trouble. It's Bartlett for Charlton, and he just couldn't divert it on target. Maybe a slight suspicion of handball there as well, but Leite was in big trouble and gave Bartlett a clear sight of goal. I think he may have used his hand, but it would have counted nonetheless. Scott Parker swaying up his options. Into Jensen again. Good run by Jensen. It's in towards Bartlett. Oh, Wellington have stopped. Good save. Kishishev. 1-0. And it will count. Everton to a man there looked across to the assistant official. He kept his flag down. And Alan Kermishley's side take the lead after 19 minutes. A second goal in four games for Kishishev. But it was a controversial one. Played in by Jensen. Well, certainly he was in an offside position, but he wasn't interfering. That was the referee's judgment. Everton will argue that Lisby was offside. But the official doesn't agree in the goal stance. They were almost within a yard of each other. And Kishishev kept his head from close range. Out to Lisby. Broke down at the vital moment, Powell's got it back, now Parker. Yule, Lisby, fantastic move from Charlton. And a terrific stop at the end of it from Wright. Would have been one of Charlton's goals of the season. Parker involved, played the ball there, and he got it back, and was denied only by Wright. Excellent stuff from the midfielder, who many are tipping to be in Svenjo and Eriksson's squad. It's named later for the friendly against Australia. Gravison. Stanley's made the overlap. Now he's got it, the Italian. Radzinski. Leads here. Oh, McBride! 1-1. What a good finish from the American. His fourth goal in five games. And 20 minutes from time. No wonder Moyes applauds. His team are level. Little fortunate in the way it came to him, McBride, but once it did, he tucked it away clinically. Radzinski involved, and Leitier somehow got it to McBride, who finished emphatically. No chance for Carney this time. Oh, Lisby got between two. Still Lisby, side netting only. Pace of the game starting to hot up again. It was a ricochet here off Weir that fell for Lisby. Angle was against him. Just there, and he got the ball back. Although couldn't make it. Kishishev's pass intercepted. Stoney came off tier inadvertently straight to Gemmell. They take that. Good chance here, though, for Naismith! Lacked composure at the vital moment, a Scott. It really opened up for him. Played in by Gemmell. Cavan down the middle there. And he hoofed it well over in the end. That's off for Chalk. Well, Sven's seen enough. He doesn't think there's going to be a late winner here. And Kirbishley won't be going anywhere. Kylie goes long this time. We've got around 7 minutes remaining. Moore trying to get in. Everton getting it away. Anywhere will do at the moment. They are under the cosh. Jensen. And again. Shishev. It came off Leeds here, hit Johansson, and it's Lisby, Kevin Lisby, 2-1 Charlton. Tucked it away really well. Leeds' involvement won't impress the Everton fans. He was a little unlucky, but Alan Kermishley won't care, frankly. And just a minute after the England manager left the ground, he's missed what may well prove to be the winning goal. What was Leeds doing there? But Lisby took full advantage. And Charlton Athletic, who've banged at the Everton door for the last 10 minutes or so, have finally found a way through. Left foot into the corner. Well, Eriksen has also missed the introduction of the wonder boy Wayne Rooney. Coming on with just 5 minutes left to play, on for Unsworth. And another young Englishman, very highly thought of, comes on, Paul Konchesky. Rooney, nice control, he's eyed up the shots, and he wasn't very far away. Charlton, the hearts in mouth there, when Rooney took aim. It was a fine strike, it was just a foot or so too high.
It's the quickest game I think we've been involved in all season, and it was end-to-end stuff, and we had a couple of opportunities after being 1-0 up to get the second, and Richard Wright pulled some great saves off. And to be fair, once they equalised, I wondered if it was going to fizzle out into a draw. And I think if you asked David, he probably would have took that and myself. But we got the winner.
What's it like to be a Charlton player right now?
Not too bad. things are going exceptionally well for us at the moment. And, you know, it was a hard-earned win today, definitely, against a side that have had a good season. But we're in the middle of a fantastic run at the moment.
I never lost confidence in the squad. You know, I knew that it was good enough to compete in the Premiership. And whoever's come in, I mean, young Kevin Lisby, for instance, you know, he wasn't starting the season, but he's come in. And whoever comes in when we've had an injury has come in and performed. But I think the major fact is that they've got the confidence. They know that they can compete in the Premiership.
We've got a target in mind, and I think that's to beat our Premiership total of 52 points a couple of seasons ago. Now, if we beat that, with what, 11 games to go, you know, we could be in the top seven, who knows.
Europe?
Maybe.
Is Scott Parker good enough for England?
Well, I don't want to, you know, obviously I think he is, but I don't want to get involved in that because, you know, I see other managers talking their players up, and perhaps we don't do that enough. If it's going to come along, it'll come along. If not now, it'll come along later. But I don't think he's done himself any harm today. Jason Yule as well, I think that, you know, and Sven should have a good look at our team because we are stocked with a few English players.
Of those players, it was Parker and Konchesky who got the call from Sven that night. A wonderful honour for both the players and the football club. Konchesky made his full debut at Upton Park against Australia, but Scott would have to wait his turn. He was an unused substitute. Back at the Valley 10 days later, an Irish World Cup hero made an emotional return. Mark Kinsella got a rousing welcome, and then Villa were sent packing.
A tangle of legs, and Parker won that one. Jensen just dribbling past a few players. Still with Charlton. Here's Bartlett. It's a bit messy. It's a handball. It was on the blind side of the referee if it was, so only the linesman on this side was going to give the decision if it was going to come. Well, two hands, Mark Kinsella and the captain, Melberg. So the supporters behind the goal who could see that did, I think, have something to shout about. Referee saying play on, and he's trying to play Parker on. Jensen, your right foot volley, and the first save for Peter Engelen comes in the afternoon. Right foot volley coming from Charlton's leading goal scorer, Jason Yule. Took it lovely as it dipped, a lovely first time touch across to him from Klaus Jensen. Yeah, Jensen just drifting into the box. Found Parker. Got some space for a shot, but doesn't give it. There's Yule. Yule turn on the right foot. He's going to. He does. And he finds the goal. wasn't the greatest of strikes. It just sort of bounced awkwardly. And I don't think Peter Enkelman will be very pleased with his defence or the way the ball just bounced awkwardly into his goal. Here it is, Jensen Parker just finding Yule. He turns and it just bobbled into the corner. Wasn't the greatest of strikes, but it's a goal. And it's Lyman this game up. Yeah, bounced in. And that's Yule's 10th goal of the season. And Villa's third corner of the afternoon. Barry going to take it. Pulled away from the keeper. Up they go. Basiris off the line. Here's Crouch, saved by the keeper. And acrobats from Scott Parker. Well, Charlton can say anything, but they were fortunate there. And Scotty Parker's overhead kick was the saviour towards the end. Was off the line first time from Scott Parker. Parker in some space. Two, three players in the box for Charlton. He's got Jensen the other way, but he's decided to go around his man. He's gone around all play, trying to get the box. This is it. There, what a lovely play. Parker just danced along the line. Went round all play. The keeper was drawn. And probably Johansson's first real touch of the game makes it 2-0. That was far too easy for Scott Parker going along the line here. There he goes, just turns round, turns all play, and just goes along the byline. And then when he's ready, puts it back, and there's the goal. I don't think Jonathan Johansson has had an easier goal to score this season. Minute into added time. Oh, it's there! Three goals here at the Valley, and it comes. It's a bit of, well, it could be an own goal. It was bouncing about in there.
Playing centre midfield with Scott Parker, is that your game now?
I think for the last 12, 13 games, I think it has been, yeah. We've been doing well together, you know. It's showed that with him getting his call up and the team's performing as well, you know. And if the fans are enjoying it, we're enjoying it. So just want to keep doing what we're doing well.
Is it a case you don't mind where you play as long as you play?
Yeah, that's it. And obviously, you want to play positions where you're going to enjoy it as well. And I'm enjoying it in there because I seem to be getting involved in the game a lot and getting in the box to score goals.
Well, it would have been no defeats in 15 games, but the one game that I know still rankles with you is that Chelsea game.
Yeah, well, that's done and dusted now. We've, you know, the FA have had a look at it and said there's no case, so we'll just get on with it now. But
you write that game off? Is your run still on?
No, we lost that game, and you know, we picked ourselves up straight away. I mean, since that game we've won five on the bounce, and we had an opportunity to do that again early on in the season, didn't do it, and it was great to do it today.
Sixth place and 45 points by the end of February was a magnificent effort. The early season flirtings with the relegation zone were now a distant memory. Alan Kerbishley received the Manager of the Month award. Charlton then came crashing down to earth as two of the top three set about them. 1 point out of nine made it a miserable march.
Edu for Arsenal.
Luke Young's just dumped Robert Perez to the floor.
And here goes Henri Jeffers! Give him the right service and he'll give you the goals. And at the other end, Lisby almost bringing Charlton level straight away. Henri. Perez is right up with him. Parker's tackle was a good one. And he didn't like that, Thierry Henry. Didn't like it at all. I must say, I didn't see anything wrong with the tackle myself, but maybe the replay will shed a different light on that incident.
Well, this is Scotty Parker's game. You know, he's competitive. You can't take that away from him. But I think the way Thierry Henry reacted right under the nose of Robert Stiles, They have to be very, very careful indeed. You know, we've seen time and time again when players have reacted in such a manner, then they have occasionally been given red cards. You can see Scotty Parker there trying to work hard. He actually gets something of the ball there. And then Henri just kicks out at the Charlton midfield player.
Ewell. Good play by Ado onto Pires. Dangerous break here. Thierry Henry on the ball. They've got Jeffers unmarked. Far post screaming for it. What a mess they made of that. And Pires has headed it in. Charlton have shot themselves in the foot in stoppage time at the end of the first half.
The ball went up front in the air. They challenged it. If we got away on the ground with Kevin Nisby, they was as quick. Midfield, which has been as strong as anything for us, you know, we couldn't get away from theirs. So, you know, we're disappointed, but we played against a great side. We know that.
Firm header by Bramble. Bellamy. He's absolutely surrounded, but he'll do well to catch up with Craig Bellamy or keep up with him. And Ewell did that, and the referee's given a penalty. Ewell is furious. You can see him accusing Bellamy of going down too easily. It's just that searing pace. He moves through the gears so quickly. Jason Ewell was always struggling to get there. There was certainly contact between them and certainly a hand in Bellamy's midriff. And eventually he was just prized off balance. Dean Kiley stands between Newcastle and the league. Every Shearer goal is an event to him, but this marks his 200th Premiership game for Newcastle and moves him to number three on the club's all-time goal-scoring hit parade.
Johansson.
He's outstripped Bramble. Down he goes. Nothing doing. But he's certainly got on the dangerous side of Bramble and Bernard there. He was just winning the race. Now, is there any contact at ground level? Or did he just lose balance of his own velocity? Maybe just got a little helping hand.
Bartlett has done well to find Jensen.
He's crying out for him to shoot, and he only just missed.
Clever from Bellamy. On by Shearer. Here goes Craig Bellamy. He's away from Fish. He's got support from Solano!
Craig Bellamy is the man that Solano, the goal scorer, is pointing to. He's been the central figure in both the Newcastle goals. Viana clear. Oh, and Bellamy has managed to slip Rufus. He's got three for company, Craig Bellamy. Rolled in towards Dyer. Kiley did just enough. Almost sport for choice there, Bellamy. And almost a goal for Dyer with his first touch.
Jensen with a free kick.
Flick from Johansson and a really good save by Gibbon.
Jonathan Johansson almost marking his return to the team with a goal.
The game was tight, I think, for 50 minutes, and their penalty turned it a little bit, and the one we didn't get given, you know, may have put us back in the game. After that, I got no complaints. You know, once it was 2-0, Newcastle showed what a dangerous side they are. They got an element of Arsenal in them and Man United on the break. Very dangerous, and, you know, it was going to end up 3 or 4, or we was going to get back in it, and neither happened.
Long throw.
Away by Ehiog. Well, that's clever from Fish. And here's Johansson. Nisby!
You were expecting the net to bulge and somehow it didn't. Nisby in today for Sean Bartlett. One of four changes that Alan Kirbishley's made. Look at this from Fish. How's that from a centre half? Johansson was onside. Perfect ball. Nisby simply should have scored. This is Jensen. looking long towards Lisby. Murphy had a couple of yards start, but he's lost his man. And Johansson is waiting, if he can find him. Still Lisby, Johansson! And he struck it straight at Schwarzer, who held on as Jensen tried to follow up on the rebound. Another really good chance for Charlton. This time Johansson is the man who's missed it. Oh, that's a really poor ball by Ehiog. He's given it straight to Lisby, and there's a break on here for Charlton. He's got Johansson ahead of him. Perfect ball, Jonathan Johansson, 1-0 the Addicts. What a tidy finish that was. Super little ball played through by Lisby. And the Finn with a clever little dummy sold Schwarzer and then rolled it in. 26 minutes played. Charlton ahead, and they deserve to be. Perfect weight on the pass. Just watch there, the little dummy that sent Schwarzer to ground. And an expert finish. Lisby and Johansson combining well, not for the first time this afternoon. Lisby. Johansson. Oh, nicely done for Konchesky. Charlton really have played some flowing stuff in this half. What can he produce here? It's Yule! Well, they really could have been out of sight, Charlton. They've scored one, they've missed at least three other excellent chances. That time it was Jason Yule after Konchesky's perfect cutback. Middlesbrough have got off lightly in this first half. Jeremy over the free kick. Jostling in the box. Oh, Jeremy's gone for goal and it's smacked off the crossbar. Kleine was definitely beaten. It's Jeremy again. Charlton get it half clear. Lofted back by Boateng. In goes Rufus. And finally the whistle goes, but Jeremy within a coat of paint there of levelling it up for Borough right at the start of the second half. Kleine just seemed to lose that. Don't know if it was the late curl that deceived him. Greening. Just had to hold it up. Might come in for Janinho. Fine save by Kiley. Janinho again. Kiley with another excellent stop to deny the Brazilian. Looked odds on an equaliser there. It is something goalkeepers practice a lot. Getting up to make the second save. The first was pretty decent. And how quickly he reacted to close the angle down. Excellent goalkeeping to keep Charlton's noses ahead. Southgate. Christie's little layoff. Space here for Kudrew, this side. In towards Christie! 1-1. Has been coming too. It's only Malcolm Christie's second goal for Middlesbrough. And it was put on a plate for him by the substitute Kudrew's excellent delivery. Now Konchesky is eyeing this up, who scored in this kind of range against Blackburn from a free kick. Can he repeat it here? Left foot curling and off the angle of post and bar. Well, he was only millimetres away from surely winning the points for Charlton Athletic. The effort from Konchesky so nearly won the game. Schwarzer was nowhere near it.
Before the match against Leeds, Herman Arideson signed for £900,000 in preparation for next season. He was ineligible for the remaining matches, a great shame given what was about to happen. Leeds arrived having just recently sacked Terry Venables, but then inflicted on Charlton their heaviest defeat for 70 years. Standards were slipping.
Now Kulas popped up on Leeds' right, has got away from Parker and has taken on Konchesky, and has picked out Viduka. And now Smith, and Kuhl, and Leeds are ahead! Well, worked in for Smith, who's gone over Rufus. It's a Leeds penalty. Alan Smith wrestling for the ball. Richard Rufus wrestling with Alan Smith. He scored 11 out of 14 penalties for Leeds. He missed one famously in Suwon against Spain, and now he faces a fellow Irishman in goal. It is Ian Hart who scores. Smith won it ahead of Rufus, and Viduka had a shot and scored terrifically well. And Leeds are turning the world on its head. 3-0 up before half-time, and this is the team that was heading down. Well, Alan Kirbishley and Mervyn Day must find this particularly hard to take on board. They have played on the other side of this fixture, of course. Alan Kirbishley for Charlton, Mervyn Day kept going for Leeds on this ground a few times. Here's Parker. He's got over Raderby, and Charlton have a penalty. Well, Lucas Raderby is adamant that he did nothing more than stand his ground. Parker's burst into the box. Oh, well, Raderby took him out. Jason Newell prepares to hit the spot kick to give Charlton some hope. He has done just that. It's 3-1, and there's a minute to play before half-time. Svensson, Parker. For Ewell, and Ewell for Parker, and what a save from Robinson. Really outstanding reflexes and elasticity from Leeds, excellent young goalkeeper. Well worked by Ewell, instinctively hit by Parker, and terrifically well turned over by Paul Robinson. Smith taking on Rufus and feeding Viduka, who scores. Renewed comfort for Leeds. Via another instinctive hit from Mark Viduka. Smith went over on a youngster challenge, and it is another penalty to Leeds. Their second, the match's third. Viduka. The afternoon that transformed Leeds United's lives. Well, taken away from Al-Khalej by Kuhl. And Kuhl's gone for goal, and Leeds have half a dozen reasons to believe that they are safe.
Been with the club 12 years, and you know, whenever I've had a bad time, I've defended the players, but I don't think I can today. All of us are in it. It was just an unbelievably bad performance.
And clearance from Friedel on by Sukurt, and here's Duff. Still Damien Duff, and Blackburn Rovers lead. 34 minutes gone. Really well taken. Started with Friedel's long clearance, he applauds the finish, and Damien Duff has beaten his fellow countryman Dean Kiling. After Sukor's flick, he got above Rufus. Good play with both feet here from Duff, and he tucked it away very nicely. Now here's a big moment for young Jamal Campbell-Rice, who's coming on to make his Charlton debut place of Kevin Lisby. He's just 20. Campbell-Rice, he had a spell on loan at Leighton Orient earlier in the season, got a couple of goals for them. This is Campbell-Rice. Still well to keep possession. Powell plays it back in again, and it might fall here for Parker. Another miscue. That's not a bad effort, and a fine save by Friedel. But Charlton has suddenly come alive here in the dying minutes. Best chance was the one that Parker miskicked. That was a brilliant effort and a fine tip over. Jeff Kennett for Birmingham City. Time to measure a ball in for Horsfield. And it really was, and Birmingham lead. Savage. That came off Yule. It's come back to Savage though. Chris Cowes across, good challenge. No, penalty. Neil Barry has pointed to the spot, but it's surely Powell played the ball. That's what you'll say. Let's have another look. Very, very harsh on Charlton. And to add insult to injury, it's Savage to take and Savage to score. And it's 2-0 Birmingham City. Very unlucky on Charlton.
It's unacceptable. And our fans are fantastic. And against Leeds, they took it on the chin. Today, they didn't. And I don't blame them. But the players are forcing it on themselves. And, you know, we're going to cause ourselves more and more problems if we start, if this carries on.
Some pride was at least restored at Anfield, but the run of results continued and there was a cruel twist at the end.
Hope you're just teasing, Nisby. Quite a heavy damp for during the half-time period, and pitch which was quite treacherous on the top in the first half will be quicker still now as Traore has just found out. And here's a chance for Bartlett. And Charlton have taken the lead. Traore lays prostrate as Sean Bartlett celebrates. Terrible moment for the young defender. Wonderful moment for the South African striker. A dazed Liverpool manager looks on. But this has been a very good Charlton season, and it's not over by a long chalk. Bartlett capitalising on Traore's personal catastrophe. And Charlton Athletic, so desperate to get their season moving again, have had the perfect start to the second half. And that half-time downpour has been the undoing of Liverpool. Risa takes in towards Gerrard. It's come for Hoppier! Just when they needed leadership the most, Liverpool get a captain's goal from Sammy Hoppier to keep alive their Champions League hopes. The corner found a way all the way through to him, and nothing that Carney could do on the line to keep him out. Jensen takes in towards you. Oh, that's a really good save by Dudek. Outstanding stop by Jerzy Dudek from Jason Yule. Such a powerful crashing header as Yule towered above the goalmouth melee. But Dudek threw himself to his right and leant back to claw the ball over the crossbar. Gerrard. He's done well to make room for a cross. Cut between Robinson and Young. Good shot, it's in! Stephen Gerrard! Final minute! The final act in the drama is provided by Stephen Gerrard. And if Gerard Houllier and his team are lining up for Champions League football at the start of next season, they will remember this heady moment. Victory snatched from the misery of defeat. It's a miserable moment for Dean Kiley, but a great moment for Gerrard, who blasted it under the Charlton goalkeeper.
We had a meeting last night and we said, you know, if there's ever a time we've got to get back to what we're good at, and we did today. And I'm very disappointed we haven't won it. I'm even more disappointed we haven't got a point. But I've got a performance, and it's just underlined what we know all along. If we don't do certain things, we don't function. And we've had a learning curve in the last couple of weeks, and let's hope we can come out of it and be stronger next year.
At last, some salvation against FA Cup finalist Southampton. Alan Kirbishley demanded a performance from his players. The club's pride was at stake.
Svensson. The tackle there from Parker. Ludwig Vaart caught it, two binds there. Bartlett could be through here. This is short Bartlett. With a side of goal, good block. In goes Parker! And a flag save to touch it away then for Paul Jones. Parker in the thick of the action. This was the effort from Bartlett. Then the follow-up from Parker. Almost poked it past Paul Jones. The Welsh international keeping goal for Southampton today.
Here's James Beattie. He's been a continual threat to Charlton today, as he is again here. Oh, what a stop that by Kiley. He says he doesn't want to play for the Republic of Ireland anymore. He certainly does for Charlton. And the deflection, Beattie's shot, it was off Ormrod there, Beattie's front-running partner. Really venomous strike two from Beattie. Klaus Jensen. This is Parker. Look at a mazy route. Still Parker. Might go all the way. He has. Oh, what a goal. Well, he's had a fantastic season for Charlton. And that epitomises really what he's all about. All the nominations for the PFA Young Player of the Year. And no wonder with this kind of form. It's a dazzling run by Parker. No defender can get to him. And he's guided it beautifully into the corner. Beyond Jones. It's a great goal from Scott Parker. Jensen, who played his part in the build-up, but from here on it was all about Parker. Look at his control here. Right into the corner, to the delight of Alan Kerbishley. Here's Jensen with the free kick clipped in, and it's Lisby's header, and it's two for Charlton. Just 4 minutes into the second half, and they have doubled their advantage. A really neat flick on then by Lisby. Jensen, who clipped it in so invitingly, and Jones couldn't reach it. Some static and nervous defending by Southampton. It's Yule. And now Fortune has suddenly popped up on the scene. And almost scored two and would have done so, but for the reflexes of Jones. Some nifty footwork from John Fortune. Here's James Beattie. Good strike. And they've got one back with a minute to go.
We've served up a pretty much a disgraceful performance the last couple. And really, you know, the fans have had nothing to shout about and we didn't really want our season to tail off. And, you know, with a win today, it's just pushed us back into things and, you know, it looks a bit better for next year now.
For him to push on and be a real good midfield player, he's got to do a bit more of that. He's got to make a few more goals and, make sure he picks out or makes the right decision around the edge of the box. And if he does that, you know, he'll push on.
If there is an ambition for next year, is it to score more goals from midfield?
Yeah, definitely. I think if that's one thing which I need to add to my game and which Kerbs is on me about is to add just that bit more goals, you know, and hopefully next year with a little bit more practice in the training and that, I can do that.
I think that he's been well noticed this year and, you know, it wouldn't surprise me if he is in the next squad, but if he isn't, he'll carry on until he gets in it, I think.
This was the weekend when the Premiership title was decided. Charlton stepped out at Old Trafford against the champions-elect and were mastered by a Dutchman.
Sylvester. That's awkward for Powell. It bounced up in front of him. Van Nistelrooy trying to claim it. This is David Beckham. It's in! Deflected, left-footed shot. They're getting closer and closer. By Keane, who played Carroll into some trouble, and Jensen stabs it goalwards, and Charlton level! A mix-up between Roy Carroll and Roy Keane has handed Klaus Jensen an immediate equaliser for Charlton Athletic. And Jensen, who scored a superb goal against United at the Valley earlier in the season, scores a wonderful opportunist goal from Carroll's hasty clearance, which left his goal unguarded. Manchester United's lead immediately wiped out. Beckham. In towards Sylvester. Michael van Nistelrooy! Goal
So best. Solskjaer on. Van Nistelrooy turning. It's another. 3-1 to Manchester United. Two for Ruud van Nistelrooy. It's a familiar story. Sylvester very quick to the ball. 4-1 for Manchester United. They look unstoppable. What a moment for an 18-year-old central defender to make his senior bow. Jose Sancoco is going to get a taste of the big time. With his team trailing by 4-1. There was that 10-15 minute period at 1-1 where the game became quite even again.
Yeah, and we was playing okay, you know, but I think Van Nistelrooy looked as if he was on a mission today, you know, and looked exceptionally sharp. No matter what team or what players would have put out, I think, you know, he was different today. And, you know, the amount of players they got there, you can't cope with everybody, and they managed to get on top and get their goals.
No, Charlton fans, you're not dreaming. This really is Real Madrid's superstar striker Fernando Morientes in an Addicks shirt. So what's going on? Truth is, the new signing is the shirt, not the player. Peter Varney and Alan Kirbishley went to Spain to clinch a deal with the club's new kit suppliers.
We're obviously going there today to get it signed, and you know, we're looking forward to the association next year.
Player of the Year Scott Parker is a less than keen flyer, but he enjoyed a taste of European travel. A welcoming party awaited at Madrid airport. And then it was out into the Spanish countryside. No sign of the Bernabéu stadium, though. But we did find a rather nice restaurant.
This is going to make into a 3-hour, 4-hour lunch.
And Scott got the chance to meet Real Madrid's latest sensation, 21-year-old striker Javier Portillo. Then it was down to business. An hour outside Madrid is the headquarters of Spanish company Homa, who'll provide the club's kit for the next 3 years. They already dress the likes of Deportivo La Coruña, Seville and Chievo in Italy. But this is their first link with an English club, and at more than £1 million, it's the biggest kit deal in Charlton's history. It'll be available before the start of next season.
You know, I'm looking around this company, and it seems to me like a Charlton company. It's got a family feel about it. And the people that work here are all committed, and they've all been around a long time. And it's definitely a family business.
From next season, Scott will be wearing Homa boots, just like Portillo and Morientes. Kirbishley is hoping for an even closer relationship.
And especially if they allow us to play some of the players who they give their boots to.
Sadly, this might be as close as Morientes gets to joining Charlton, but the party from South East London were still happy with their day's business.
We do keep the ticket prices quite affordable at Charlton, and so we need to make sure that on the commercial front we've got that little extra edge. And obviously to enter the European market after only 3 years being back in the Premiership, it's a nice feeling today.
So the company that kits out top sides in Italy, in Spain, and even national teams like Costa Rica has finally branched out into England, and they've chosen Charlton to do it. The Addicks may not be playing European football next season, but at least they'll look the part.
And so to the final day of a truly eventful season. The Valley packed out once again as Charlton bring down the curtain on a third successive year in the top 20.
Before kickoff, Scott Parker received the accolade as Charlton's Player of the Year, and there was a special presentation to John Robinson, leaving on a free transfer after more than 10 years at Charlton. John is, of course, on the Christmas card list of all referees, but more importantly, gave his all for this football club during a very successful decade.
And again, Robinson! Oh, that's an outstanding goal!
The flag has stayed down. Robinson's in the middle. And Robson's, oh, a wonderful goal!
Robinson's made a good run to the back post! And he's found perfectly! Robinson for Charlton, 6-5.
Kinsella, and it's in! Robinson! What a comeback from Charlton!
Against Fulham, though, the season was about to end as it began, with a London derby defeat that hinged on a controversial sending off.
Fulham continues to look the better team. Flag stays down. Sahar is clattered by Kiley. That is going to be a free kick and possibly a red card. It is a red card. Dean Kiley, the Charlton goalkeeper, ends the season with a red card. And is it a penalty? I think he's inside. I think that's a penalty as well. Sahar certainly suffering a painful blow. The left elbow looked high. And Dermot Gallagher in no doubt whatsoever that that was a red card offence. It will be a penalty for Fulham. And Ben Roberts will be coming on. Question is, who will be going off as Kiely makes his way off the pitch for the last time this season? If it looks like it's going to be Sean Bartlett, the South African striker, who is being sacrificed. And on comes Ben Roberts, former Middlesbrough goalkeeper, played in the FA Cup final against Chelsea in 1997. And his first bit of action this afternoon is to try and save the penalty to be taken by the man who was fouled by Dean Kiely and has won the penalty. Sahar against Roberts. It's 1-0 Fulham, and Louis Sahar has his seventh of the season. Roberts guessed the right way and got a touch as well, but not a strong enough palm away to get the ball away. And no wonder Sahar looks slightly relieved. Dior tries to get the better of Gomar, and probably has done, and it's a penalty to Charlton. Alan Gomar seemed to be tugging on the shirt of Jason Yule. Let's have a look. Ewell was strong and just a little bit too quick and awkward for Gomar. Went down easily, offering the opportunity to Dermot Gallagher to level things up penalty-wise. It's a golden opportunity for Charlton to restore parity. And just like Sahar, Ewell won the penalty. Can he put it away? No, he can't. Just like Roberts in the first half, Mike Taylor guessed the right way, but unlike Roberts, he got his hand firmly to the ball, and Charlton are kept out. Fairly weakly struck by Ewell.
The final league table, and Charlton missed out by just 1 point on a top-half finish. 12th place was a far cry from their early season form, but there was disappointment that they'd fallen short of their previous best return of 52 points.
So Charlton Athletic look forward to a fourth straight year in the Premiership and the anticipation of once again mixing it with the very best. We hope you've enjoyed this review of the season. Let's leave the last word to the manager, Alan Kerbishley.
We had a very difficult start, as everybody knows, you know, and the first four home games were really tough. And with the injuries now, we've had a difficult run in, but in saying that, in between that, I think our performances, certainly before Christmas, after Christmas, you know, championship form we produced, and we showed, I think, the Premiership that, you know, we can compete with anyone in there.
Obviously, you look at the campaign in three sections, if you like. I mean, you must have been a worried man during that first part of the season where results were poor.
Well, I think if you're realistic in the Premiership, you look at a group of fixtures that come along and you know that if you don't get it right, you could be badly hurt. And we didn't get it right. We lost at home to Chelsea, unluckily, and then got beat by Spurs. And then you had suddenly Arsenal and Man United coming up all at home. But we picked points up away. So, no, I wasn't that disappointed. I think we ended up with 10 points from 10 games, which was a decent haul. We then felt, like last season, before Christmas and after Christmas, there was points there for us and we grabbed them, and we put some great displays in. And, you know, then after that, I think we have tailed off like last year, but I think there's been some mitigating circumstances this year. As everybody knows, there's no Rowett, no Rufus, no Fish. Horizon couldn't play. And I think that's affected us enormously in this running. But, you know, that's what the squad's for. So people are playing now and they're getting great, valuable experience. But Scotty came back, Jason Yule moved back into midfield, We changed it around a little bit and it picked up from there. And as I said, the performances were fantastic, and we shouldn't forget them, because I think, you know, there was some great football played, and, you know, that's when all our players got noticed, I think. And, you know, there's been international recognition for one or two of them, if not around the country anyway. So, no, it was a good time. And as I say, I think a lot of people will perhaps concentrate on the end, because that's the last thing that's happened. But have a look at the season. It's been a good season. For us to do what we've done is a fantastic achievement. And, you know, perhaps people's expectations next year may be greater, but you can't take it away from the players what they've done in the last 3 years. They've established themselves, I think, in the Premiership. I think there have been some fantastic games, but certainly I think the Everton game at the Valley, two teams totally committed and playing at their best, I think, and we managed to just scrape it 2-1, but it was a great game. But I think the game that, for me, had everything was the West Ham game. Local derby, they'd made a couple of new signings just after Christmas, and it was a 4-2 win for us, and it was a great night. And I think them two games certainly were the best two games for me.
And you'd be reluctant to pick out individuals, but is there a player that you think has developed, made progress, surprised you this season? You know,
I think the player has obviously been Scotty, because what's happened to Scott this year is obviously the first 10 games we badly missed him. He then came back and gave us a lift, and, you know, whenever he didn't play, or didn't play very well, it was noticeable and it affected the team. So I think he's come through and established himself now as a major player for us and a major influence.
What would your message finally to the fans be who might share your sense of disappointment about the end of the season?
I think they should have a look at the league table, and you know, it's not that bad. It's a fantastic achievement, and they should be thinking that next year could even be better. That's the way I see it.